let's start with the Tarragon. We're sitting in the Tarragon. We're sitting in the space. What was your first experience of this space?
Of this place?
Yeah, this room.
Well, I have to go back in time and talk about how I came to come to the Tarragon with a script. Is that what you want to talk about?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, in the summer of 1971, I was in Prince Edward Island, and I wrote the first draft of a play called The Keepers of the House. I think it's a quote from Ecclesiastes. The title, that's where the title came from. That's what Leaving Home was originally called. And I came back to Toronto with that script. It was a one-act, 60-minute play. Stage play, and I was standing in my sister-in-law's kitchen one day, and she said to me, you know, there's a new theater opened up by the railroad tracks, up in Howland and Bridgman. You should go there. I said, what for? She says, well, there's a play there that you should see. I said, really? She said, yeah, it's about people with cerebral palsy. I said, you know what? I don't think I want to see that. I don't think so. She said, oh, you know, you should go because it got terrific reviews. And I went up to the Tarragon Theater on a Sunday pay what you can matinee, dropped 25 cents into the poor box, into the pay what you can box. That's all I had in my pocket. And I sat there with all these people and watched David Freeman's play called Creeps, set in a sheltered workshop. And a bloody thing devastated me. And all during the production, I kept thinking, who directed this? Because whoever directed this, I want this person to direct my play if I can ever find a director for it. And when it was over, I waited for everybody to leave the theater, and I walked into the office, and there was a woman there. Apparently now, Bill told me it was Jane Glasgow. I always thought it was some young woman, just a worker in the theater. But Bill said, no, it was Jane. And she was sitting with her feet up on the desk reading a book. And I said, who directed that play? She said, Bill Glasgow. And I said, is he here? She says, no, he's not. He's at home. I said, can I have his number? She wrote it down on a piece of paper and gave it to me. And I said, can I use your phone? She said, yeah, okay. So I phoned, ring, 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 hello. Bill Glasgow? He said, yes. I said, Mr. Glasgow, you don't know me. My name is David French, and I've written a play. Oh? I said, yeah, would you read it? He said, yeah, okay, yeah, I would. I said, you would? He said, yeah, I would. I said, well, if you like it, would you do it this year? Can you imagine that? He said, well, as a matter of fact, he said, we don't have a play for the last slot in May. He said, because of the first play was Creeps, first play was Creeps, and it was a big hit. But the four plays following that all flopped, and Bill was going to close the theater. So he said, we don't have a play for the last slot. If I like your play, of course I'd do it. So I dropped the play off. I still hadn't met Bill. I dropped the play off at the theater, and a couple of days later, he called me and said, come on in, I like your play, come in and talk to me. So, I went up to the theater thinking, oh boy, this could be my big break, you know? This could be my big break. The guy's gonna read my play. So I get up there, and I wait outside the theater for this guy, and he comes loping up the street towards me. This 6'4" guy with a tweed jacket with leather elbow patches, a beard. And he said, come on, let's go in the green room. We'll talk in there. And Bill and I, after this experience, never went in the green room again, ever. So we went into the green room, and he sat there with my script in his lap, facing us like you and I, facing me the way you are right now, except closer, knee almost touching my knees. And he said to me, "You know, I like this play, but I don't think you've realized the full potential in it." I grabbed that script out of his lap, and I leaped to my feet, and I called him every profanity I knew, and I knew a lot of them. And now, Bill said that the reason he chased me was because Jane told him to go after me. I didn't know this. I didn't know this until shortly before Bill died. And he chased me out of the theater. He grabbed me in front of me. He put his great big hands on my shoulders. And he stopped me and he said, look at you. Come on back. Come on. Cool down, for God's sakes. He said, come on back. Let's talk. He said, I'm your friend, not your enemy. So that was the last fight Bill and I ever had, except for we used to fight over things in the play, really, but little things, but it was never serious. But we never, ever went in that green room together. So that was how Bill and I met, and that's how we ended up at the Tarragon.
I'd not heard that story.
That's a story. I could go into much more detail, but that's basically the story.
And what was in it that made you snap and grab the script from
him? I was the world's most insecure guy. I mean, I spent years trying to write for the CBC, and there was one woman down there at the CBC who was a story editor, and I would take a script into her, sometimes an hour and a half script, and she'd praise it to the skies, and by the time I left the office, I'd be a mess of insecurity because she'd start to cut away at it and criticize me in all kinds of different ways. And I thought, oh, this guy, he's like her.
Right.
And I freaked out. I think that's what it was, just my own insecurity.
So did Bill and you then work on the text, or did it stay as
well,
it was?
Well, Bill and I worked on the text from the... That was in October. Now, we didn't open until May, something rather, the end of May. So we worked on the script till then, yeah. Basically, Bill didn't know how to tell how to fix a script, but he knew that he could say, this section here is something not quite right about it, David. Go home and think about it. It's not working. That kind of criticism, which is what I like.
Right.
I don't want somebody telling me too specifically what's wrong with something.
Right.
Because sometimes they don't know what they're talking about. Even the people who supposedly do know what they're talking about often don't. And so we worked, it was called The Keepers of the House. Bill hated the title, I hated the title, and neither one of us could come up with a good one. So one day I'm in my apartment and the phone rings and it's Bill. He says, I've got the title. I said, you do? He says, yeah, I was driving along the Gardner and I almost went off the road. God damn it, he said, the title came to me and I almost drove off the road. I said, okay, Bill, what is it? He said, are you sitting down? I said, no, I'm standing up. He said, sit down. I said, no, I'm standing up. He said, okay, leaving home. I said, leaving home? He said, yeah, leaving home. You like it? I said, no, I don't. He said, you don't like the title? I said, no, I don't. He said, what don't you like about it? I said, I don't know, Bill. I don't like the title. He said, are you sure? I said, yeah. He said, okay. And he hung up. And as soon as he put the phone down, I thought to myself, wow, what a wonderful title. What a wonderful title. But I couldn't find him. It took me about 2 hours to locate him again to tell him that I liked the title. So that's how we ended up with Leaving Home. Bill thought of it. However, several months later, when I was going through my notes for that play, one of the titles I had was Leaving Home, and I'd forgotten all about it.
Wow.
Completely forgotten that I ever called it that.
And how much of that original text changed to the production?
Oh, a lot of it changed. For example, one of the really good criticisms Bill gave me, he said, look, David, he said, Minnie and Harold are only in the play for 10 pages. That's all they were, 10 minutes. He said, they're two wonderful characters. You've got to try to keep them in the play longer than that. He didn't know how to do it, right. But he wanted me to try. So I kept them in for 60 pages. That's
yeah.
How long they finally ended up being in the play, 60 more minutes. Things like that. And he said, the humor keeps bubbling out of this play. Keep going for it.
Right.
Because up until then, I wasn't very funny. Well, I used to cut the humor out of my plays.
Why?
I don't know. I didn't think it was serious if you had humor in it.
How old were you then?
I was 32.
You had written earlier plays.
I'd written plays for television for 10 years.
Right.
I saw my first television play back in 1963 to CBC in Montreal. And for 10 years, I sold plays to the CBC in Montreal and Toronto. They were always, Bob, I didn't really write for television, except I wrote for Razzle Dazzle, a kids show. But I didn't really write for television. I wrote one-act stage plays, 30 minutes long, one set, two or three characters, that I sold to television.
Right.
My apprenticeship in the theater was really in television.
Your interest really was theater, it wasn't television.
No, but there was no place to put on those plays.
Right.
So I used to sell them to the CBC.
Right. And once it got going with Bill and the Tarragon, did you write any more for television?
Well, within 2 weeks, there was something on television that I had written, but I had sold it before Leaving Home opened. After that, no, not really, no.
You're a theater animal.
I've made my living from the theater, yeah, since 1972.
And are you happy with that, or do you look at a TV career or a film career and go?
I don't want to go near television.
Why?
Well, I never learned anything. I mean, I know that sounds odd, but I used to write these plays, and they used to put them in front of a television camera, just the way I wrote them. Nobody ever asked me to change anything,
right,
or talk about it or anything else.
Right.
So, and I was longing to somebody to give me some kind of criticism.
So at the end of the process with Bill taking Leaving Home, from the initial script to what it opened with, how did the young 32-year-old David French see the journey of the changes in the script? And you guys were both learning together.
Yeah.
Right.
Exactly.
You were learning text and script and structure, and Bill was learning and how do you deal with the new writers.
See, Bob, I already taught myself. I have to go back again in time. After I saw my first play to television, it was a play called, one-act play called Beckons the Dark River, about these two kids who commit suicide. And they're crossing the River Styx. And they decide at the end of the play to go back towards life. And that I sold when I was 23 years old. I wrote it in 18 hours, sitting on a floor with a pencil and a pad of paper. And I typed it up and sent it to CBC in Montreal. In those days, at 11:30 on Sunday night, there was a show in Montreal called Shoestring Theatre. And they used to do plays. So I sold them a number of plays, but that was the first one.
And those were tape dramas?
Yeah, they're probably still around.
Was it live to tape, or was it live?
Live on tape.
Wasn't live to broadcast?
No.
They taped it, edited it,
yeah,
and then played it, right? And those plays have never had a further life.
No, I've never seen them since.
Were the Mercers in those plays?
No, they weren't, and not at all. I was still struggling to learn how to write a play. However, I know what I lost my train of thought, Bob. Now, what I'm trying to say now is that after I saw that first play, I realized I didn't know what the hell I had done. Because I wrote it in 18 hours, sitting on the floor with a pad, right, pad and a pencil. It was a very intuitive act. Now I decided, if I'm going to write plays, I want to know what I'm doing. I want to know the craft. So I sat down and started studying plays from the Greeks right up to the present time. It took me 9 years. I spent 9 years learning or teaching myself the craft of writing a play, and I still haven't learned it. I'm still struggling with it. it's a very complex and intricate art.
Have you ever felt tempted to experiment with the form of how a play moves?
Not if it goes against the heart of a play, which is action. Plays are all about action, as David Mamet always points out. He's right. There are some things you can't fool around with a play. There's some things, of course, you can. There are no rules. There are principles.
I'm shrinking through the floor at this moment because I didn't write a play, but I wrote a thing about my family in the First World War, right. And you say plays are all about action, and now I sink through the floor. There was zero action, almost zero action in the piece I wrote.
Yeah.
And I thought if I went back to rewrite that, I have to find some ways to put motion or action in that play.
When I talk to young playwrights, I always say, go down and see Glengarry Glenn Ross. Study that play, just that one play, and you'll understand what playwriting's all about. It's got everything. It's even got the fact that they have to do it quickly. The action has to be
right.
A couple of days. And everybody's desperate in that play. Everybody has a tremendous motivation, a life and death situation. It has to be life and death, metaphorically or literally, in a play. Or else, why would people sit there in this theater, or any theater, 50 seats, 2,000 seats, and watch people on a stage if it isn't life and death? Why would they do that? I wouldn't. Nothing bores me more than watching people who aren't motivated strongly enough to hold an audience. You have to compel the audience to sit there, and that they pay good money to watch us.
And you mean life and death physically, life and death emotionally, life and death spiritually, life and death identity-wise?
Yeah. Absolutely.
I wish I'd heard that phrase before I directed some of your plays, because I mean I see those eventually in the plays as I directed them. But if I'd known that kind of key signature when I went in, I would have maybe got further faster. Because Jacob Mercer is entirely a life and death character.
He is.
Right.
Yes.
Is that what makes him?
The other characters in Leaving Home, for example, have life and death situations. Literally or figuratively, you know?
And when did you realize that? That plays have to be about life and death?
I realized that from studying plays.
Ah, right. So a light boulevard comedy doesn't interest you?
No,
I mean, jitters.
No,
I mean,
no. Jitters is a...
Is all life and...
Every character in that is motivated. It's a literal or metaphorical... matter of life and death.
Right. Let's go back to Leaving Home.
Mm-hmm.
And let's talk a bit about the rehearsals and how you as a young writer watched these. But you had seen your television stuff done before. Did you sit in all the rehearsals with Leaving Home here?
Every single day, and I still... I used to be a joke here because sat in, I still do it, even the Soul Pepper, I still sit in on every single rehearsal. But I sat in on every single rehearsal in this theater. But not only that, I saw every goddamn production, every performance. I couldn't stay away.
Why?
I felt if I wasn't standing at the back of that theater watching it, it would disappear. That's how I felt.
What, the play would disappear or the actress would take it to place?
It wouldn't exist if I wasn't there to see it. Is that ego or what?
That's mysterious, David.
Yeah. That's how I felt. So I used, and then of course the actors knew that I was there all the time. And if I was sick or had the flu or something, they'd say, what? He doesn't like us anymore? So I had to be there. Even if I was sick, I had to show up.
Because that can, sometimes it's difficult for actors to have the writer sitting there because you think, I'm not doing it right. You can project criticism into the writer's head.
Yeah. No, you know, before we start rehearsals with any show, I always tell the actors, look, I'm going to walk around. I'm not being rude. My back will be turned to you. I may be listening for five or 10 minutes. I said, I can tell more about the play, whether it's right or wrong, by listening to it rather than watching it. So don't think that I'm being rude to you guys. I'm trying to rewrite the play. But I can't. I can tell much more by listening to it.
Right. But say at Soulpepper with Of the Fields Lately or something.
I still do it.
You didn't. You attended, but you didn't rewrite. Are you listening to the play or the production?
Yeah, I'm just listening to what is. Maybe there's something that I can tell Ted Dykstra to help him as a director. I'm not going to rewrite the play, no. That play exists in a certain time and place, and I'm not going to rewrite it, no. I don't think it needs it.
And let's go back to leaving home here, opening your first audiences. What was that like?
With Other Fields Lately?
No, Leaving Home.
Leaving Home. Well, the opening night of Leaving Home was sort of a legendary experience because I didn't invite my parents. I was a coward. I thought I'd hurt them too much, so I didn't invite them. So I came into the theater, opening night, looked in, and there was two rows of my family sitting here. So I went backstage, and the fights were going on. We had the legendary fights going on during Leaving Home.
Like what?
Well, certain actors weren't getting along with certain other actors. As you know, Bob, that often happens in the theater. And
was Sean Sullivan in it?
Yeah, Sean Sullivan. See, Sean Sullivan ended up being the dark side of Patrick Flanagan in Jitters.
Right.
And Jerry Parks was the rhythms of speech of Patrick Flanagan are Jerry Parks, but the dark side of that character is Sean Sullivan. Well, Sean didn't get along well with Lisa Creighton, who played Minnie. So I go backstage opening night, 15 minutes before the curtain. I quit, she said, I quit. She grabbed up fur coat, threw on her fur coat, and stormed out. And the stage manager chased her down under the bridge and physically tackled her under the bridge, threw her over his shoulder, and brought her back kicking and screaming and sat her down in the chair in the green room and said, "You're going on!" And that was it. So I'm watching, this is my first play. I'm watching this stuff happen. I was a wreck. So we... And then the play ends, and there is absolute silence in the theater. And it goes on and on and on. And I thought, oh, geez, they hate it. And all of a sudden, the entire theater leaped to its feet as one. Urgell Crater once told me that it was one of the three spontaneous standing ovations he ever saw in the theater. We go back to Bill Glasgow's house for the party. Turn on the 11 o'clock news, and Jeanine Manatis was the critic at that time. And she reviewed it for the CBC. She hated it. She panned it. She tore it to ribbons. That was the first review of Leaving Home. And everybody in Bill Glasgow's house gave it a big raspberry to review. And so I'm standing there in the house waiting for Herbert Whittaker to show up because I was told, somebody had told me this, that if Herbie liked the play, he was with a male critic, if he liked the play, he'd come to the party. But only if he liked the play, he would come to the party. So I'm standing in the hall, looking at the front door, just wishing Herbie would walk through, willing him to walk through that door. And finally, the door opened and in walked Herbert Whittaker. And so I knew I had a good review, and I did. Next day was a good review from Herbert Whittaker. But the next morning, the one review that I was terrified about was Urgell Crater. He could kill you with a word. Everybody knew that. So I was terrified of his review. So my wife and I got down to the Zumburger at St. George and Bloor, a little restaurant, bought a couple of newspapers, the Globe and Mail and the Star, and we went inside for a coffee. And we're sitting there facing each other. And I said, "You read it." And I was like this. She says, "Are you sure?" I said, "Yeah, you read it. I can't read it." And so she opens. So we didn't go near the Globe and Mail review first because it was a good one anyway. We knew that. We went to the one that was going to destroy us. So she opened up the paper, and she finally found the review, and I'm watching her face, and she starts to go white as that piece of paper there. She went pale, pale, pale. And then the tears started to stream down her face. And I said, God, is it that bad? She said, no, it's a rave. It's a rave. And Bob, my life just changed like that. Just like that. My life was never the same afterwards.
In terms of your career or in terms of what David French thought about his writing?
Both.
Right.
Because within a year, there were about 35 productions of the play in Canada.
Right. So in a Canadian theater sense, you rocketed to stardom.
Yeah, well, that play opened up the gates to the regional theaters for Canadian plays.
Right.
It's astonishing what happened. Because up until then, it was all American and British imports, hits. But they suddenly realized that they could make money from a Canadian play.
Right.
And they started booking it.
Here we're talking about success, and suddenly here's a play that'll move out, and here's a young writer who suddenly is being asked. But I also want to talk about the insecurity inside, because you talk of this insecurity that you have or had. So how do you deal with your own insecurity as you write, as you pace, as you watch, as you read the next review?
I think my insecurity is the source of my creativity. I mean, I think it's a good thing. I'm glad I'm insecure. I don't want to ever be secure.
Meaning if you were secure, you'd never write another play?
I think so. I that's how I feel. I think it's like the grain of sand inside the oyster.
Right.
It's the pearl.
On the opening night of Leaving Home, did you sit in the audience or did you were in the foyer?
Nobody would sit with me. Nobody would sit with me.
Why?
I was a wreck. But Jane Glasgow finally said, I'll sit with you. So we sat down around here, somewhere around this section here, and she held my hand. She said, I'll hold your hand. So she held my hand, and the lights, the house lights went out, stage lights came on, and I started to faint. I said, Jane, I'm fainting. She said, what do you mean? I said, I'm seeing stars, Jane. She said, bend over and put your head between your knees. So I did. For about 10 minutes, I sat there listening to my play with my head between my knees. And till the stars went away. Then I sat up.
And your family, who were in the first two
they
rows?
They loved it.
They were there.
They were there.
Were your mother and father there?
Yeah, they were.
And how did you deal with the fact that you thought you'd perhaps written them a bit too tough in the play, and there they were watching themselves?
They surprised the hell out of me because they didn't think that my parents were the kind of people that didn't care what you said about them as long as it was true. So they loved the play. They were up till 5 or 6 o'clock in the morning arguing about it and discussing it. And they weren't put off by the play or hurt by the play at all.
Did they see themselves in it?
Oh yeah. My father used to refer to the Leaving Home as the play that you're based on me. Remember that character, you're based on me?
Wow.
That's all. But one time we were walking along Bloor Street and he said to me, you know that play Leaving Home? He said, that's about me and my father, isn't it? And I said, yeah, it is. Well, it was. It was about him and his father. It's about my father and me, too. It's about all fathers and sons.
Was your dad alive when you wrote Of the Fields Lately?
Yeah, he was. We became actually good friends after I wrote the first two plays.
You weren't friends before that?
Well, not the same way, no.
Right.
He lived to see Jitters, but he never lived to see A Saltwater Moon. Neither did my mother. And that's the one play I wish they had both lived to see, you know. And 49.
Yeah.
1949. Because I treated them much more kindly in those plays.
Were you trepidatious when you wrote about your parents in leaving home, thinking, are my mother and father ever going to see what I'm writing about them?
No, I knew they'd see it. And, you know, I was worried about what they would think, but not that worried. It wouldn't stop me.
Right.
So I don't know what that says about me, but it says probably that I knew intuitively more about them than I realized, the kind of people they were. They didn't hold any grudges towards me.
Because it often comes up with the young writers who write about their family, who write about their immediate family. How raw do you make the truth? I mean, there's a kid in Montreal just wrote the play, you know, wrote the film, I Killed My Mother. You know, how raw does a young writer dare to be about people who are closest to him?
Well, the question about being raw doesn't ever enter my mind. It's whatever's the action in the play, motivating the characters. I never think about how raw the emotion is. I think of making the strongest action I can possibly come up with to hold that audience there while they watch it. Or else they're looking at their watch wondering, hey, I wonder where I can get a latte after this show, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And if they're looking at their watches, you've lost them. You might as well go and sell used cars.
Let's talk about two plays, as it were. Leaving Home, which is this force of a play that is about life and death and grabbed us all when we saw it. And Of the Fields Lately, which I adore as a play. It has a lyricism to it, and it is life and death.
Yeah.
But there's a lyric and there's layers in it that haunt. How did you write Of the Fields Lately with the same, I'm going to make action, it's going to be life and death? Why is that play different than Of the Fields?
Different in what sense?
Of the Fields Lately for me has has a yearning in it of a kind of different kind of temperature, and I don't want to get out too artsy fartsy here, but it has a different kind of haunt and yearning and ache in it. And Leaving Home is a more muscular drive to it, equally as emotional, but this haunting yearning in Of the Fields.
I think probably that comes from the fact that my wife and I had split. And I think that's where the yearning and the ache comes from the separation.
Right.
Everything bleeds, everything in my life bleeds into my work in some way or other. Even if it's not obvious, it does. For example, Saltwater Moon is all about my wife and I. It's really a play. People think it's a play about my father and mother. It's really a play about my wife and I. But it's also a play about my father and mother. But the reason I understood it so well was because it was about my wife and I. And I could go back in time and put that in the past.
Right.
What was happening to me at the moment, I could put in the past and make it real. I understood it immediately. Because when I first started the play, Saltwater Moon, I thought, there's no way I can set a play in Newfoundland in 1926. You know, I wasn't born until 1939, and I only lived in Newfoundland for 6 years, first 6 years of my life. I don't know the place well enough. But I did it because I wrote about my wife and I.
Right.
And also, I was smart enough to make a liability into an asset. Because if I had gone down the road or inside that house in Saltwater Moon, I wouldn't have been able to write the play. But I thought, if you stick to the yard and the porch, you can do it. You know enough about the yard and the porch. But don't go inside that house and don't go down the road. So that's what I did. And I started out with about 20 characters and ended up with two. I kept throwing them out.
Who were the other characters?
Oh, all the people that are mentioned in the play. There were all kinds of offstage characters. When I start a play, I never know how many characters I'm going to have. I don't know how many acts or how many scenes. I don't know anything really. It's all a discovery.
And so what's the germ that starts a play for you?
Usually one or two characters in a situation of conflict. And the play, of course, the play doesn't start when the curtain goes up. The play starts way, way back in the past. It always does. Always. All you're doing is finding the sort of a crest of a wave when a play opens. But that's not the beginning of the play. The play began way in the past. Every one of my plays do that.
I'm just realizing now that that is something that comes on stage in your plays, that we hear the preceding years in your plays really potently, as it were. Whereas in other work, a lot of plays just start when they start and they finish.
But
what's happened before, you kind of bring on stage in a way that, and not in kind of memory speeches and not like, do you remember when speeches, you bring that on. How? How do you do that?
Well, I don't know. that's the answer. I mean, I don't know. Yeah. I don't know how I do it. I guess it's because I have a certain amount of craft in my fingers, and my fingers just do it. And I rewrite and rewrite and rewrite. I'll rewrite a page 60 times, you know, to get a simple line of simple page of dialogue. I'll write it 60 times.
Different versions of the page, or pruning it down?
Pruning it down, usually. Compressing it, all that.
Right.
Usually not a lot of changes, but it's just the compression. It's like, that's why I think I write poetry, you know.
Right. And who's your first audience? Who first reads that page?
Oh, I'm the audience. There's nobody else. I write a play for David French sitting in an empty theater in the middle of the first row. That's the audience. Because I know if I can satisfy that guy, he's just an ordinary theater goer. If I can satisfy him, I can satisfy her and him and that guy over there and, you know, this person. Because we're all alike. But I'm no better. I'm a good barometer, but I'm no better than anybody else. So I write for that guy.
And are you a demanding David French?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Every comma has to be in place. Every semicolon. Yeah, every period. You know, every dot, dot, dot. You know, so. Every monosyllable that doesn't belong in the play goes out the door. And every one that should be in the play stays in. That's why I demand actors get it word perfect. Because I have struggled. I mean, it takes me 1 year to 4 years to write a play.
Right.
1 to 4 years to write a play. So I'm not dicking around here. I know what I'm doing. And I've worked my ass off doing it. So somebody who comes along and thinks that they can change my line after reading the play once, they're full of shit. They're not getting anywhere with me.
That's the Jacob Mercer in you?
Yeah, that is. You haven't seen anything yet.
What is the most, you and Bill working on all the different scripts you've worked on, what is the most radical changes that have come in a script that you've worked on? Has there any been that half of them have chucked out and you started again? Or is it basically the same?
I mean, the thing is about Bill Glasgow, well, he was a tremendous man. He wasn't in the business of as some theaters are, of doing only hit plays. Bill was there, and he told me this once. He said, I'm more concerned about your development as a writer than you turn out a hit play all the time. And that was his attitude.
Right.
That was always his attitude. He would do anything that I came up with because he thought it was further my development. Whereas nowadays, Jesus, if they don't think it's going to be a hit, they don't want to go near it.
Mm-hmm.
They don't care about the writer's development.
But it is. I mean, we are sitting in one of the better writers' theaters in Canada.
Absolutely.
And both Urjo and Richard Rose have kept up that strain of it. What's it like to have been such the center of Canadian writing? You know, there were about three or four of you who are really the center of Canadian writing, and now all the younger writers and your plays are done less, and, you know, Albert's remounting them here, but what's it like? I mean, I only talk from my own experience, right? As an actor, you enter, suddenly the career opens up, and you're in the center of the industry, and then as you get older, you feel yourself being drifted or drifting to the edges of the industry.
It's scary. I think one of the things, even when I had the success with leaving home, it was part of it is terrifying because you've got new responsibilities, and I tried to write about the fear of success in jitters. That's one of the fears. Fear of failure is in it, but it's also the fear of success. It changes your life completely and gives you new responsibilities and new stress. And everybody's waiting to cut you down. I always feel that in this country. Well, it isn't in this country. It's everywhere. It happens to Chekhov. It happens to everybody. They wait for you. They give you a big success. They build you up, and then they cut you down. Even with Chekhov. It's something endemic in the creative communities, I think. I think it's just there. And I sort of accept it, part of me, but I resent it too.
And is it a healthy reflex?
I don't know if it's healthy, but it's real. Everybody complains about it. Who's ever had any success? Mm-hmm. They're just waiting to get knocked down. And they usually do.
It's a little different in this country too. I mean, if you follow, you know, something like Pinter, you know, he kind of roars to success with early plays and then has a kind of medium part to his career and he continues to write well and then he's off to the side at the end. But that's a different culture in that there's a deeper respect for just writing and a deeper respect for the place of the artist in the culture. Whereas in our culture, we don't have that yet. The arts do not sit, you know, in the body of Canadian culture, we're on the side.
Yeah.
We're still the kids who put on bits of entertainment on the edges. And it's, so criticism cuts deeper in a way, I think, for us. And Hollywood in America is very different because their career trajectories are so astronomically high.
Yeah, there's no ceiling there.
But when they fall.
Yeah. That was one of the things I always noticed when I had shows in America. They used to look at me. I could feel it too. They used to look at me like, this guy could be the next Tennessee Williams or Arthur Miller. That's the way they looked at you. Until they found out that you weren't. There was always that possibility there. And they treated you very differently. Because in America, there is no ceiling.
That's right. And did you like that when they looked at you that way?
Yes, I did. Yeah, I did.
And is that an illusion, a dream, a bubble? Because again, I think of my own career early on. Oh, you should go to Hollywood. Oh, they're looking at this film. Oh, the next young actor. And suddenly, oh my God, you could be that kind of actor.
Yeah.
And then that kind of expectation very quickly gets...
Yeah. Well, you know...
Is that because we don't make dreams here? We don't have myths about ourselves?
Well, I'm trying to create myths about myself.
But your myths have got the feet on the ground, though. Myths have...
But I always thought I was trying to create a mythology with the Mercer plays.
In what way?
Well, it's all about immigrants in America. It's the one great subject, I think, of the 20th century, immigration. And I always wanted to create a whole dynasty of...
Well, you have.
Yeah, I think so. And I'm still trying. I'm still working on another Mercer play, but I don't know if I'll ever finish it. Number six?
Right.
But I can never guarantee that I'm going to finish anything until it's finished.
And how far along are you?
About halfway through it.
Were you ever approached, because part of the conversation that I'm wanting, that we are having, is there's the art of it. You know, what you say, you want to communicate, you want to tell stories. And part of it is the career of it. And for the young writers who I hope are watching some of this interview, eventually, that the pull of the art of it and what you want to do as an artist, as a writer, and then the career of it, and how do you manage the careers, the ups and downs, the catastrophes, the praise, and then the executions.
The career, I somehow just stumble around. I've managed to have a career since 72, well, since way before that, though, because I wrote for television. I don't know how I do it. I just do it. It just happens. Things just happen.
Right.
People want to do my plays, and like my agents gives them permission to do them. That's my career.
And do you read extensively?
Yeah, I do.
Who are your favorite writers?
What kind of writers are we talking about?
We'll say playwrights.
Well, anybody who's any good.
Mamet.
Mamet's a good playwright.
What is it you like about Mamet?
I like all the things that we've been talking about. The fact that he believes that plays are all about action, and of course language. Language and action. I actually think that I learned more about writing plays from studying Hemingway than I ever did from studying any playwright. Because, you know, he always talked about those virtues of simplicity and economy and accuracy and, you know, those kind of virtues.
Right.
And I took that from prose into plays. I thought, if that works as a novelist, that's got to work as a playwright too.
And I'm just wondering if writing, other people's writing invigorates you like that, or
oh,
you
does.
Need that kind of thing.
It does. It's why I became a writer in the first place, before I even knew how I became a writer, Bob. Did you ever hear that story?
No.
Well, again, it's got to do with reading. I was in grade 8 at Bronson Public School. I was a class clown, very destructive kid. And it was 2 days before I got out of grade 8, and we had a teacher named Mr. Bean, and he said, "French, shut up." He said, "Get up here to the bookcase and take a book and sit down and read it." And he said, "You're disrupting everybody." So I slouched up to the bookcase, grabbed the first book I saw. I didn't know what it was. I just grabbed the book and sat down in my seat, and I opened up the book. It was Tom Sawyer by Mark Twain. And I started to read this thing. And before I got halfway through it, not only did I want to be a writer, I knew I was. I knew I was.
Because the words excited you, the story excited you?
Yeah, absolutely. I knew I was a writer. And within 2 months, I was publishing little pieces of poetry and short stories in the Canadian Boy, the little glossy magazine. And so that was 15 years old. So I did that. That's my first sale. And I wrote my first play when I was 23. And how I wrote that, I had a girlfriend in Montreal. We broke up one night. And I was going back to Toronto to put my head in the oven. I was going to kill myself. So I got on the bus with my typewriter. And I'm sitting there in a seat, and moonlight on the snow. The bus was dark, and I started to get this idea. These two kids, they commit suicide. And at the end of the play, they go back towards life. This idea was going around in my head. I saw, literally saw, this old shack by a river with smoke curling up around the steps, mist curling up around the steps. And down the road, the surrealistic road, came this young girl. And she interacted with this old guy inside the shack, and I suddenly realized he's the boatman. I didn't know this. He's the boatman that carries these souls across the River Styx. And a little while later, this down the road comes this young guy, and he interacts with her and him. And at the end, they decide to go back towards life. Well, I couldn't wait to get off the bus. I didn't want to kill myself anymore. I wanted to write this play. So I rushed home, and I was living with two actors, the corner of Charles and Young, over a Greek restaurant. It's no longer there. And I sat, that we had no furniture. So I grabbed a pad, a paper, and a pencil, and I sat on the kitchen floor for 18 hours and wrote this play called Beckons the Dark River. If I were writing it now, I would just call it Dark River. But I call it Beckons the Dark River. And I wrote it in 18 hours, typed it up when I finished, sent it back to the CBC in Montreal. They bought the goddamn thing for $400, which was a lot of money in those days, right, for me. And that was my first sale, my first play.
So you talk about life and death, you talk of action, you talk of blood. And there you've just described to me a situation of your life, of blood, of life and death, that you then, it pours out in a play.
Yeah. But all my plays come out of my life. Even when they don't appear to, they do. Some more obviously than others.
When you do talk to young writers, because you do workshops and you go to some writing places, what do you say to young writers?
I always ask them, I guess, is why do you want to write plays? And I usually ask them, do you like, what plays do you read? And they look at me. I say, well, just give me two plays that you've read. They don't read plays.
Right.
They don't read plays. They don't go to the theater, and they want to write plays. I said, you realize that you're dealing with one of the most difficult literary and dramatic forms in the world? And you don't go to the theater and you don't read plays? How in the hell are you going to write plays? I said, writers learn from reading and writing. That's how they learn. Those are the only ways that you can learn. You read plays and you write plays. And they haven't got a clue how much hard work goes into them. And I always try to stress that too.
Right.
And getting away from the stupid idea of glamour. God, they think this is glamorous. I suppose it is if you have a hit play every time you go out, but who does? Nobody does.
I'm dismayed how many writers in Canadian theatre and American theatre go to television. I feel like we lose.
Yeah.
When they bleed away like that,
yeah.
It drives me crazy.
Yeah. Well, thank God I did it in the reverse order, so I have no interest in going there.
Right.
Because I started there.
But if the guys in Hollywood phoned you up and said, David, you know, we want to put you on a $150,000 retainer contract, and we want you to look at some scripts and do some rewriting for us.
Well, you know, I've sort of had all that. I mean, I was offered, when we did Off the Fields lately in New York, I was offered a movie deal. But I didn't want to write a movie. I said, I'm quite happy writing plays right now. I mean, I've turned down all kinds of stuff in television and film. And I've also tried to work in film, but the money always fell through. Several of my plays have been optioned, and I've written screenplays for them, but we never came up with the money.
Which ones?
One Crack Out, Saltwater Moon, Of the Fields Lately, and a number of productions of one crack at one time was going to be done by Jim Brown and Rick Torn, but the money fell through. Always the problem.
Is that a regret for you?
Yeah, it is. I would like to have done it with those two guys.
Right.
They were friends, and they were both good.
Right.
They would have been wonderful, especially Rick Torn.
Boy. And for you as a writer who was based in words, and you, as the theater scene is shifting, and there's more imagistic theater, there's more, you know, strings down. There's here Robert Lepage, who's very script light and very image heavy. Where does that place you?
I don't know. I have no idea where it places me. I don't even think that way. Where do you think it places me?
Well, I don't know, because again, it's like, you know, careers that they rise, they move, they're in the center, and then they drift, and then they're pushed, or whatever. I mean, I sometimes feel, well, am I now the old-fashioned person who likes well-crafted words and a well-crafted play? And no, maybe
stop
I'm just
thinking old. That way. Stop thinking that way.
But maybe it's true.
Well, I think that's dangerous to start thinking that way. Because my experience with leaving home taught me something about what's trendy. When I decided I was going to write that play, I thought the only way I can write this play is to write a realistic family play. But I thought, Jesus, that's old hat, that's passé, you know. But I thought I was being tremendously brave and courageous by flying right in the face of fashion. And you know what? It worked. So it's exactly what I did, and I had a successful play. I wasn't worried about being trendy or being fashionable. Actually, I thought I was going to get slaughtered for that reason.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely. Even Bill was worried about it. He said to me, you know, there's going to be a lot of people hating you for writing this play. And I said, why, Bill? He said, well, because it's going to make them feel things that they don't want to feel. He said some interesting things before we opened. One of the things he said to me was, look, we're going to run this play for 6 weeks. If it doesn't do well, we'll close it in three weeks. But don't expect to make any more than $30 or $40 a week. That's what he told me. He also told me that if it wasn't successful, he'd had to close here because of what happened, because of Creeps being the only one that was a successful play that year. And he couldn't afford to keep going. I said, thanks, Bill, I need that pressure. That was good. So anyway, it worked out.
And what made Bill so important for you? I mean, I want to talk a bit about Bill and for people to know that man, because I never interviewed him. What was it about him that made this place take root and then move and then be so successful?
This place?
Yeah, Tarragon.
Well, I think Bill was only concerned with doing good work. As I said before, he was not concerned with only writing, producing hit plays. He was really concerned with the development of writers, not just me,
right.
other writers as well.
But he obviously had an ability to choose writers who could write.
Yeah,
he didn't wait to see what the audience figures were.
His instincts were good. However, you know, as I said, he told me that it was Jane who told him to go after me. He wasn't going to do it, he told me. That was very interesting confession. I told Jane that, and she says, he told you that? I said, yes, he did. She was surprised.
Because mano o mano, he thought, well, this guy is just giving me the finger.
Absolutely.
I'm not going to...
Yeah. But he listened to her.
Right.
And that was Bill, too. He didn't have any... Bill seemed to lack an ego, you know? He wasn't... he didn't have that kind of ego that other people have. I mean, a lot of these artistic directors will not hire somebody who's more talented than they are. Bill would every time if he could. He didn't care if they showed him up.
Yep.
He was just concerned about doing good work.
Because certainly there was criticism of Bill's directing.
Yeah.
You know, as the skill of directors became very auteurish, Bill was often criticized and often given hard times in rehearsals by various casts.
Yes. And various playwrights, including myself. Bill and I didn't always get along in rehearsals, but I could tell him. We talked in shorthand, Bob, basically. I'd watch something and I'd go up to Bill and I'd say, Bill, that was shit. I'd whisper it to him, that was shit. He'd say, oh, I know exactly what you mean. He knew exactly, I didn't have to say anything else, just that was shit. And he'd go away and correct it.
That's shorthand?
Yeah,
shit?
That was shorthand. That was shorthand, and he knew exactly what I meant. He didn't have to say, what do you mean?
Well, the way an actor is playing a moment or the way a scene was staged or?
Both. He'd say, I'll fix it after lunch or after the break.
Right.
Because probably, whatever was bugging me about the scene was also bugging him. And as soon as I said that it was shit, he understood exactly what it was because he was thinking about it himself. And that's the kind of relationship we had. We talked in shorthand.
So he did basically always trust your instinct? Or did you have some instincts that were loggerheads?
He always trusted me. He said, it's your play. He said, I'm going to do it, whether he would do the play whether he thought it was working or not. He didn't think Jitters was working. He came up to me one time when we were doing Jitters and said, how the hell did you know that was going to work? I said, it made me laugh, Bill.
Right.
He says, because I didn't think it was going to. But that wouldn't stop him from doing it. Because I wrote the play, and he wanted to do it as further my development.
Right. Are there directors now that you feel strongly about, positively?
Yeah, I do. I have Ted Dykstra.
Right.
He's the only one I'm working with now.
Right. Because Ted's done Saltwater Moon. He's done Out of the Fields.
He's done Out of the Fields. And he's going to be doing Jitters.
Jitters, right. Right. And have you ever seen actors, I don't ask this question because I am an actor, but have you ever seen actors take a part in one of your plays to a place further or more interesting than you thought that part could go?
No. No. I usually find the opposite. They don't take it far enough.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Because they don't have the imagination for it, or the courage for it, or the... Let's take the example of Jacob Mercer.
Mm-hmm.
If an actor is afraid or wary of taking a character to an extreme of emotional violence, an actor sometimes won't go there because they'll feel they don't look good.
I'll give you an example of this. There was a production of Leaving Home in Ottawa years and years ago. I went to see it. And at the end of the play, the actor playing Jacob walks over, doesn't take his belt off and beat Ben. He walks over to Ben, grabs him by the scruff of the neck, drags him to the door, opens the door and shoves him out. That's not my play. And I went back afterwards and I said, why the hell did the director do that? And I was told by the producer that he couldn't handle the violence in the play. I said, well, Bill Glasgow couldn't handle the violence either. I mean, he's a very gentle man, but he serves the play. You're supposed to serve the play. That happens too. That same night, during the climactic scene, Jacob walked off stage. He dried. He walked off stage, got his cue, and came back on. The next day, the review came out saying how Mr. French let down the actors in that scene by having Jacob walk off stage. So, you know, we get credit for things, but we also get blamed for things.
Yeah. And in terms of directors taking your play and adding elements, you don't like that?
No, I don't.
So let's talk specifically about Saltwater Moon.
Okay.
That I directed down at Parsborough. So I added the ghost of Bob Foote.
Yeah. That's writing another character into the play that shouldn't be there.
Right. So that just is automatically offside.
Yeah. If it wasn't you, Bob, I would have said something.
But why didn't you say something?
Because you're Bob.
Oh, well, thank
you're
you.
Bob. But
but you don't put control on your plays like the Beckett Estate, saying they will be done this way and no other way?
Well, I after a few experiences like that, I now have in my contract where they're not allowed to change the sexual gender.
Right.
What else? Well, basically, they're not actors are not allowed to change lines without written permission from the author.
Right. Totally. Reasonably.
Yeah. It's reasonable.
But in this case, Saltwater Moon and putting the ghost of Bob Foote, who I think played the violin, was silent.
He did.
No words.
He played the violin.
He played the violin.
He played it well, too.
He was a Serbian refugee.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, it was a very interesting story because he had it that. But there's no possibility that you can, and I'm not trying to get you to okay my choice, but is there never an addition by a director to the play that you've set that you think actually enhances the play?
Well, you see, if somebody had come to me and said, can I do this? I would have thought about it and I either said yes or no, but I wasn't given a choice.
Right.
Nobody told me that was going to happen. I was so surprised when it did. But I've seen other characters stuck in my play that I didn't. I went to a play one night, one of my plays, and I thought I had come to an O'Casey play. There were guys in overcoats and trench coats and sneaking around the houses and, you know. I actually got up and thought, I've come to the wrong theater.
Right. And do you say something afterwards, or?
I did. I threatened to sue them. And they weren't going to change it the next night. And I said, my agent contacted them and said, you're facing a lawsuit if you don't. And they changed it.
On what grounds? In your contract with the theater, you say certain changes can't be made, right? Transgender or
no, they can't change that. They can't put characters in that I never wrote.
Right. If they speak.
No, whether they speak or not.
So here's another. I did a production of the Fields Lightning in Calgary, and I added wordlessly. I added because I wanted to see the coffin, and I wanted to see the male mourners, and I wanted to see that maleness. So I added at the top of the show, the coffin, and the backs of the men sitting in the kitchen, and then getting up and taking the coffin off.
The only trouble with that, Bob, is that because I saw that production down east.
Oh, right, right.
And I was very confused by it. I'll tell you why. I couldn't figure out who was in the coffin. Whether it was Jacob, who dies at the end of Up the Fields Lately,
right.
Or Dot.
It's Ben. Ben's relationship to that coffin tells you who's inside.
But you don't know that when the play starts.
Well, I suppose it could have been Dot, yeah.
Because I heard somebody say, who died?
But in this case, it's a director saying, I adore the play, and I want a color at the beginning. I want a tone. And I know David's written it that way, but I want a tone in there as well to understand the maleness and the maleness of this. And partly was that my father had died, and there had been the men carrying his coffin and his corpse. And so that was also playing on me. So here's a director, which you don't have to like, adding a color to to the beginning of the play to propel it slightly differently.
Now, I have no problem with adding a color as long as it's not confusing.
Right.
And that confused me.
Right.
And I wrote the play, and I couldn't figure out who was in the coffin. That was my problem.
Right. Have you ever sued a theater?
Oh, of course not. Who's got the money to sue a theater?
What theater's got the money to pay a lawsuit? I want to talk about this moment a bit. So, I heard one version that Bill said adapt to Chekhov to deal with.
He said what?
Adapt to Chekhov for to deal with writer's block. Is that true?
Well, what happened was I had writer's block, and after I guess I wrote One Crack Out, and Bill said to me, "All right, the important thing is to keep you working." Again, that's Bill. Keep you working. So I said, "How do we do that, Bill?" He said, "Well, let's do a translation." I said, "Bill, I'm still struggling with English." You know what I mean? So he said, "No, let's do." He said, if you could do a play, translate a play, what play would you like to translate? I said, well, I'd like to do Ibsen's Lady from the Sea. He said, oh, that's terrific. He said, let me see if I can get somebody to do a literal translation for you. He went away and came back, and he said, he can't do it for another year, this guy that I approached. He said, let's do a Russian play. I said, okay. He said, let's do The Seagull. I said, okay. He said, it's about us, about the theater. I said, yeah, that's how that happened. Simple. You want to keep me working. So we, you know, he got Donna Orwin on board. She did the literal translation for us. And the rest is history.
It is an iconic photograph for me.
Yeah.
Not only because the artists who are gathered around it, not only the strength of the talent in that room, in the director, in the writer, in the performers. There's Peterson, there's Coulter. I mean, look at them. But it also, the photograph itself centers on a text. At the center of this picture, all lines go to a book, go to the words, which is very iconic for me. And it's also iconic because it's talking about Canadian theater and where it thought it might go.
Hmm?
It's talking about where it thought it might go, looking at the kind of trajectory of how the Russian theater moved so wonderfully at that moment.
And everybody's in the same attitude that the original people were in. Chekhov right in the center.
And some of the more modern or the recent productions of Chekhov in the last 20 years to have a lot more of the robust humor and kind of absurdity of the text.
And when I did the translation for The Seagull, I tried to find every bit of humor in it I could find. Because Donna Orwin said to me, before we started, she said, David, burn this into your brain. She said, Chekhov is simple, he's clear, and he's funny. And I never forgot that.
Because this photograph and that production not only was about a play that I enjoyed seeing, but it's about the hopes and the aspirations of a whole Canadian community.
Yeah.
That's what's in that picture for me. What are your best memories from the theater?
Of the theater?
Of any theater. Most of us have kind of pinnacle experiences that sometimes we go, yes.
Of the theater or a theatrical experience? Reading Ergio Carrera's review the next morning was one of the highlights of my life because it changed my life completely. It was actually a life-changing review.
But did it change what David French thought of himself, or did it change just David's career?
It gave me a bit more confidence.
Right.
Not that it gave me a total confidence, because I never will ever have that. But it gave me something. It made me feel good about myself.
And does that last?
Well, you know, I was an 18-year overnight success. That's what I was. Because, you know, I started publishing when I was 15, and I wrote Leaving Home when I was, it opened when I was 33. That's 18 years. It's a long time, struggling, wondering when I was ever gonna, I always knew I would, you know, that was the interesting part. I always knew I would be successful, but I didn't think it would happen so fast.
Right.
18 years, to me, it was fast. Because usually the apprenticeship is about 10 years, but I thought mine was going to be longer. And I was quite willing to work, to still be there working my ass off.
But if a complimentary review makes you feel better about yourself, and I speak from my personal experience, if a good review makes you feel good about yourself, a bad review does the reverse. And part of me has become to resent those kind, the power that that criticism has over me, both to make me feel good and also to undermine who I think I am. Yeah. And I resent that a lot now, and I'm not free of that.
I mean, I only really remember the bad reviews.
Why?
I don't know. But it's true, I think, with a lot of writers. They don't always remember the good ones. But the bad ones really stick.
Do you remember a moment we met on Bloor Street? Hmm? We met on Bloor Street. Shakespeare Works, the company I was one of the starters of, had just received massively destructive reviews, and Soldier's Heart had come out right. And received a kick in the head. You got a kick in the head. And I still remember your rage over that. And I wondered, here's David with a huge career and such a wonderful body of work, and he's still enraged.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
That a script is so kicked in the head.
Oh, absolutely, because it's like one of my kids. It's like somebody saying, Jesus Christ, that's an ugly little kid. That's how I feel when somebody does that to me. I take it very, very personally. But then again, I always believe that everything's personal.
Do you think David Mamet still reads his reviews?
Yeah, I do. Of course. Especially Mamet. I mean, you know, there's so much at stake.
Let's talk a bit about being a Newfoundlander. How much do you feel a Newfoundlander, and how much of you, because you came to Central Canada when you were six.
Yeah, we came here when I was six, but I've always felt like I was a Newfoundlander. Always. I always felt I was Newfoundlander first. I don't know. There's something about Newfoundlanders. It's really deep in the bone. My father used to sit in Toronto and, 40 years after he left, and if he was watching a television show and the water was lapping up on the shore, he'd start to cry. That's how deep it was in him.
Right.
Just any kind of wave coming over the shore.
Because the Newfoundlanders have contributed so much to Canada in terms of the voice that comes, whether it's Pinsent or Rick Mercer or Rex Murphy or you know, Mary Walsh.
I mean, all good people.
All good people who have this real muscular core, emotional core on the inside. Why? Is it the ruggedness? Is it the 400 years of rough history?
It may be isolation. I don't know what it is. I don't know what it is, Bob, because I left when I was six.
Right.
I'm not an expert on this at all. I don't pretend to be. I'm always surprised when people think that I am an expert on this. I'm not.
One of your plays that I enjoyed the most, not in terms of the fulfillment of the fields lately, but in a very different way, was 1949.
Yes.
It was like a breath of fresh air to hear the referendum or the vote talked about in a play. Was that hard to write, that play?
No, I wrote it very easily. I wrote it in 1 year. It's my longest play, and I wrote it very quickly. Whereas my shortest play, it took me 4 years to write, and that's Saltwater Moon. I never know how long these things are going to take. But when Bill took over the center stage, he said to me, okay, you can have as many characters as you want now in a play. I said, like Bill, 25? He said, yeah. I said, really? He said, yeah. So I went away and I came back with the play. It's 14 characters in that play. And he gulped. I remember he. I watched his throat. He gulped, and but he did the play. But it doesn't get a lot of productions. One of the reasons why is because it's damn expensive now to do with, play with 14 characters. I hope Soul Pepper does it.
And what did you think of Bill teaming up with Guy Sprung?
I thought it was a big mistake. But
in what way? In what way?
Well, I thought they were mismatched, just temperaments. But
did you and Bill talk about it?
No, never.
Jitters, comedy. How do you write comedy?
Jeez, I don't know how you write comedy. It's no different than writing anything else, as far as I'm concerned. It's just, they're all hard to write.
But did you set out purposely to say this is going to be a comedic play?
Well, how Jitters came about was Bill and I were in New York City, looking at theater, looking at plays. We always like to go down every once in a while and see some plays. We were down there, and we went to see David Mamet's A Life in the Theater. It was at the Lucille Lortel Theater, well, it was actually called the Theater Delice in those days. It's now called the Lucille Lortel Theater. And we saw the play, and we left the theater. We're walking up the street, and Bill said to me, what do you think? I said, I didn't care for it, Bill. He said, I didn't either. He said, you know what? He said, you could write a better play about the theater than that. I said, you think so? He said, yeah. So I went home and started making notes for Jitters right away. And Jitters, of course, is what Bill and I went through putting on Leaving Home with the Tarragon.
Right.
That's where that comes from.
So the quitting on opening night, 15 minutes before the curtain is.
Yeah, all that's. And of course, some experiences from other productions. But basically, the germ of the play is what we went through putting on that play here. And I had the title immediately. When I first sat down to write the play, I just wrote Jitters at the top of the. I don't even know why I did that. But I thought it was going to be about fear. But I wanted to be fear in a funny way. I thought Jitters was a funny title. So and I never changed the title.
It's interesting to see you're writing a comedy about fear, because when you talk about life and death situations, they're all based on fear.
Yeah, absolutely.
I've always thought the root of all comedy is fear.
Yeah, or desperation. Desperation is even stronger. And I think that's the characters in Jitters are all desperate. Especially the Phil Mastorakis. Based on my good friend George Spurdakis. George did 4 productions of that play. Oh, God.
But if everyone in the theater was sane and well-balanced, first, it wouldn't be very exciting.
Well, there'd be no plays anyway, so they're all sane and well-balanced.
And what about neurotics? I mean, maybe there's more on my side of the profession. I mean, certainly there is a sprinkling of neurotics in every generation, which can overtake productions. They just overpower them.
Yeah.
The polite term is high maintenance, but
yeah. Well, you know, when we did the original production of Leaving Home, Sean Sullivan came in one day with a note from his doctor saying he couldn't go on. He was going to quit the show. I had to talk him out of it. Bill and I spent a whole afternoon talking him out of it. And of course, when we did it down in the States, Roly Hugel, I had to hold Roly's hand for about 2 weeks. He was going to quit every day because he thought he was ruining the play.
It's at Long Wharf.
Yeah, at Long Wharf. It was brilliant. He ran for 6 months there. But Roly was convinced he was ruining the play.
Why?
I don't know why. David, I'm ruining this play. I said, no, you're not. You're going to be wonderful. Of course, he got wonderful reviews. Mm-hmm. I don't know. He's neurotic. He was neurotic. Thank God. Look how talented he was.
And so while Jitters was playing at Long Wharf, along comes Noises Off.
Yeah, that was a tragedy there. Because Noises Off was written and produced 2 years after Jitters. But it got the Broadway first.
Right. So you had interest for Jitters on Broadway and...
We had 8 offers to go to Broadway. 8 offers. Bill and I chose the wrong person. We chose Arthur Kanter, who had produced on Golden Pond. And he turned out to be the wrong guy. He was like, I liked him personally. He was like an old Spencer Tracy guy with his braces and his white shirt, you know. However, he was the wrong guy. And June Havoc was in it. She wouldn't do the play as written. And then another actor named Jack Aronson, he wouldn't do the play as written.
So they were demanding changes?
Yeah.
Because they were asking changes of the wrong writer.
The wrong writer.
He was a guy from Newfoundland in Toronto who didn't feel like changing the script for some actors or directors.
Actually, I made some changes for them, but...
Did Bill put pressure on you, saying, David, can get to Broadway if you change?
No, it was like the first reading of the play. I stood there listening to this reading and knowing that I was screwed. It was so awful, the reading. And when it was over, June Havoc said to Bill, I want to talk to him alone, me. So she took me into this room, sat me down on a chair, and said, listen, kid, you're going to make $1 million from this show. And I'm thinking, no, I'm going to make more than that. I believe I was. So she said, but the trouble is, I'm the star of this show, and I'm not even in it. She wanted all the funny lines that Patrick was getting and Phil was getting. They were too funny. She wanted some of those lines. Of course, when we told George, he went, he just went crazy.
So how did the deal fall apart?
Well, it fell apart when we went to Philadelphia. And we got bad reviews for the opening in Philadelphia. So then we had proof that we tried to get rid of June Havoc and Jack Aronson.
Right.
And Bill and I believe this is true. We even went to the producer and offered to give up our royalties, both Bill and myself, if they would fire them, those two people, those two actors, and they wouldn't do it. Now, the only reason is there must have been June must have had a lot of money in the show. That's the only thing we could come up with. Because they sat there for about 15 minutes, the producer and the associate producer, with their mouths open after that offer. I mean, nobody in the history of the theater had ever offered to give up the royalties. But we did. If they would get rid of them. And we brought in other directors from New York who saw... There was one director who had seen the show 5 or 6 times. A very famous man. He said, get rid of them. But they wouldn't do it. Mm-hmm. It was terribly painful because we all knew what we had in our hands. We had a show that everybody in New York was talking about. Cab drivers were sending people to it, you know, and everything else. Mike Nichols at the theater had the flop. We had the hit.
But you never made it. Did it come from Philadelphia?
No, but it was running in the New Haven, right, at the Long Wharf.
Oh, I see.
For 6 months.
Yeah.
Mike Nichols had a musical there that got bad reviews. We had the hit.
And losing that pipeline to that kind of success, was that difficult for you?
It was painful. But I just figured I'd come back with something else.
Oh, with another play.
With another play.
And?
It didn't happen. It's all about timing.
Right. And would the absence, if Noises Off was not present, would the Jitters have done better?
One of the problems was we were offered to take the show immediately to Broadway. But the problem was, poor Bill, he had to come back here and do a show. And the show flopped.
Right.
And meanwhile, Noises Off got to Broadway first. So that was the end of that.
Is that a large regret in your life or a small regret?
It's a very, very big, painful regret. Well, it's not a regret. I mean, I didn't do anything. So it's nothing that I could have done, except I made a wrong choice with a producer. That I regret, I guess.
Did you and Bill choose that producer? Or
yeah, we did. Bill and I were like two hillbillies, you know. We met June Havoc. She just charmed us out of the trees. We were batting her big blue eyes at us. And we fell like a couple of hicks. So we went back to Arthur and said, oh yeah, she's wonderful. We'll go with her. Well, it didn't work out.
June was looking for a vehicle for herself.
Yeah. She said, oh boys, it's an ensemble play. It's all about us. But that's not the way she saw it. It's all about her.
Yeah. So were there serious attempts to go down to New York after that?
With that play?
With other plays of yours?
Well, you know, I was on Broadway with the Seagull.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And I was on Broadway with Of the Fields Lately.
Oh.
So, the one that should have taken off was Jitters, and it never had a chance.
And how was Of the Fields received?
It got some good reviews. Chris Cooper played Ben.
Right.
It ran 8 previews and 8 performances and closed. When the original off-Broadway production, you couldn't get a seat. Walter Kerr, the critic, tried 4 times to get in to see that show and couldn't get in. It got rave reviews from the New York Times and the Post. We got all kinds of offers to go to Broadway. And I went to Broadway with the same cast, an extra couple of weeks rehearsal. Different critics came, nibbled away at us, and ended up being, I guess, a flop in one sense.
But that's not, as I read it, that's not really important to the core of who David French is.
No, it isn't. No. I didn't think it was a flop. I thought it was a brilliant show. But Chris Cooper was wonderful as Ben. He was this 23-year-old Missouri tense actor.
Right.
He was wonderful.
No, you saw the Other Fields Lately that I played Ben in.
Yeah.
And I was not the actor who was here at Tarragon. I guess I was cast for TV reasons. I don't know why
that,
I was
that
cast.
That was Tim Henry.
That's right, Tim Henry. And I must admit, I had no idea what I was doing. When I went back and directed the play, I thought, when I saw Ben's story later in life when I read it, I couldn't believe how little I knew what I was doing or what the play was about when I did it.
Was that because it was film?
No, because I was young and totally inexperienced and didn't know how to read a play and didn't know how to hear a story, right? I think that's why. But I was just riveted with embarrassment later in life at how little I understood of the part I was supposed to be playing. And I've regretted that ever since, and you know, I try to correct for it in other ways. What did you think?
I guess I felt it was a bit too stagey.
Me or the production?
The whole thing.
This was a production where Mike Newell, the director, had a
director.
Set built in the middle of the studio with had windows and pieces of wall that moved up and down so he could run a 15-minute sequence and from room to room inside the set, and the cameras would move around us as they shot and poke through a window or a wall piece. It was a very clever concept.
Well, he was a very clever guy. But the play has to work on between Jacob and Ben, for sure.
Yeah.
For sure. Or there's no play.
Yeah, we sort of talked about this in
What's
terms
that?
Of, well, you know, when you were starting, it was the Canadian play, it was Creeps, it was writing, it was all about words and actors written by, and now we're into imagistic theater, we're into more musical elements, we're into more abstractions. Is that something that you look forward to in theater, or?
I look forward to going to the theater
every time I go to the theater and being entertained. That's all I look forward to, being entertained. I don't know what else I would look forward to. I'm not looking for new forms or anything else. I don't care what the form is.
Can you describe who you're seeing in the picture?
Who am I seeing?
Yeah.
What do you mean? I'm still looking at myself.
This is a young man with long hair.
Sure is. Oh, Christ. He's got long hair, too.
This is your life, David.
Holy God. Now the hair is kind of white.
This is not a mirror, or maybe it is.
Holy moly. Where did all the years go?
Wow. They're in the plays, David. That's where the years are, and they'll live forever because those plays will be around forever. I mean, that's where I envy you. My work disappears. It blows away. And yours will be produced again and again and again and again and it'll look back on. So that's where I envy you.
I hope you're right.
I hope so, too.